Hey, how's it going everyone? I'm White Pointer, and as I've been covering graphical tricks on classic consoles, I've had a few requests in my comments sections asking me to cover the Neo Geo. So, who am I to refuse? Since I've done videos on the Super Nintendo, Mega Drive, and the TurboGrafx-16, I guess that's the most logical place to go from here. So here is a video about SNK's powerhouse platform that was hyped up on steroids, the Neo Geo. The Neo Geo consisted of two distinct products, the MVS or multi-video system and the AES or advanced entertainment system. The MVS was an arcade machine that was unique in the fact that unlike many other arcade boards at the time, which were typically only one game, it acted almost like a console, being able to swap games easily with special interchangeable cartridges. It wasn't the first arcade system to come up with the idea of swapping games, but it was the most successful, and the first to do it so quickly and effortlessly. Just swap the cartridge, change the artwork on the cabinet, and away you go. These cartridges were massive in physical size too, but there is a logical explanation for that which I'll get to a little later. The AES, on the other hand, was the home console product. It contained essentially identical hardware to the MVS, retaining full compatibility, and included an arcade-like joystick as its standard controller, which meant its games were arcade perfect with no compromises. You weren't just getting a port of the arcade game, you were getting the actual arcade game. MVS and AES cartridges were not interchangeable, that is, MVS cartridges were not compatible with the AES and vice versa, but third-party converters eventually became available that allowed MVS games to be played on AES consoles. For a lot of retro collectors, buying the arcade MVS cartridges and using a converter is a much cheaper option than buying AES cartridges. Yes, so let's get onto that old chestnut, the price of the thing, the AES console in particular. Yes, it was ridiculously expensive. When it first launched towards the end of 1990, SNK wanted $650 US for it, which in 2024 would be roughly equivalent to, let's see. Yikes, almost $1,600. Even the games themselves were crazily priced at hundreds of dollars each, and most of those AES cartridges have only gone up in value since then. It was so expensive, in fact, that initially it was only found in some hotels and other establishments that rented them, because SNK figured that no regular consumer would actually want to buy one. As it turns out, they figured wrong. Gamers started contacting SNK, informing them that they wanted to own the devices for themselves, and were more than willing to say,
"Shut up and take my money!"
However, it remained a luxury product for those that could afford it, only selling around a million units in total, which included sales of the cheaper Neo Geo CD. But it's important to remember that SNK were not trying to compete with the SNES, Mega Drive and other consoles. They had their own niche and it was enough for the system to still be profitable for them. SNK stopped manufacturing hardware in 1997, but incredibly, kept supporting it with new games until 2004, which was well into the sixth console generation. In fact, that was the year before the Xbox 360 launched. It also innovated in being the first console to save games to a memory card. You think it would have been a disc-based console, like the PlayStation, that would be the first to do this, but nope, it was the cartridge-based Neo Geo, which I guess was an added advantage when they released the Neo Geo CD after a few years in an attempt to bring the cost down. You could even save the game on your AES console, then plug the memory card into an MVS arcade machine and continue your game. I'm not really sure why you'd sink coins into an arcade machine to play the literally exact same game you paid many hundreds of dollars for to play at home, but hey, the option was there. Alright, that's the basic history out of the way, so let's get into some nitty-gritty details. The Neo Geo actually had the same Motorola 68000 CPU that the Mega Drive had, but it was clocked much faster, running at 12 MHz in comparison to 7.67 MHz for Sega's machine. It also contained a 4 MHz Zilog coprocessor, which once again was clocked faster than the Mega Drive's equivalent. The chipset for its GPU was custom built, using a 24-bit data bus and being capable of displaying 4,096 colours on screen at once, out of a possible 65,536. In comparison to the Super Nintendo, that managed 256 colours simultaneously, out of a possible 32,768. It could also draw up to 380 sprites on screen at once, at 96 per scan line, whereas the SNES, in comparison, could hit 128 sprites on screen at once at 32 per scan line. The Neo Geo sprites could be huge too, being able to stretch the entire height of the screen and then some, although it could only be 16 pixels wide. However, there's a reason for that. It's because unlike the other consoles at the time, it technically did not have any background layers. That's right, there were no background tile maps at all. In my TurboGrafx-16 video, I explained how that system often used layered sprites to create the illusion that there was more than one background layer, which was all the console could support. Well, SNK looked at that idea and took it one step further by making everything sprites. That's right, pretty much everything you see drawn to the screen on the Neo Geo is sprites, with priority being determined by the order they appear in VRAM. Although it must be said that sprites in Neo Geo Land aren't quite the same as sprites in Nintendo and Sega Land, as they were made up a bit differently. While its graphics were still built out of tiles, just like the other consoles on the market, unlike those other consoles, there was no background tile maps, with the backgrounds instead all being sprite tiles. When you look at a game like this, with all that stuff going on in the background, now you know those are actually all sprites. All of the scrolling and parallaxing, all of the fancy 3D looking effects, all of the seemingly multiple layers, everything. It's all sprite tiles. This allowed it to basically have as many background layers as developers wanted. There really wasn't a hard restriction, provided they didn't exceed the sprite limit. It could also pull off line scrolling in a similar way to other consoles too. However, I said pretty much everything was sprites earlier because, well, technically, not everything you see on the screen are sprites. The Neo Geo did actually have a second layer, called the fixed layer, which was usually used to display HUDs and text. This was not constructed out of sprites and instead were essentially just regular tiles. It was always the highest priority, sitting on top of everything else, but could not be scrolled. If we take a look at this example, we can break it down to see exactly how this scene is constructed. We can see all of the different layers of sprites that make up the background, the sprites that make up the characters, and the sprites that are part of the HUD. We can also see the HUD itself, which is the health bars, timer, super meters, and various text, sitting on the fixed layer. If you remember, I mentioned that the sprites could be really tall, stretching well beyond the limits of the screen, up to 512 pixels tall actually, but could only be 16 pixels wide. The background layers were usually built out of many of these tall vertical strips of sprites that were stuck together side by side. Once you know this, it becomes clear why the Neo Geo needed to have such a high sprite limit on screen per scan line. Besides being much faster and capable of throwing more sprites and colours at the screen than anything else at the time, not even taking into account its impressive sound chip, which I won't be covering in this video, it had a few unique features built into the hardware too. One of them was sprite scaling, which is something that none of its contemporaries were capable of, at least not without the help of enhancement chips. The Super Nintendo's Super FX chip was capable of it, but the Neo Geo had it built into its base hardware. It must be said though that it's technically only sprite shrinking, as it could only make them smaller, not enlarge them. So what's actually going on when you're looking at a game like this one, where it seems to be making them bigger? They're doing a bit of a magic trick here by starting the sprite in an already shrunken state and then simply restoring it back to its original size. It can't be made larger than its original size, but it can be returned to its original size, so that's exactly what's going on here. The sprites are being stored in their biggest size possible, and the hardware is shrinking and restoring them appropriately. Sprites could be shrunk and restored on the vertical axis, horizontal axis, or both, with pixel-perfect accuracy using its special line sprite controller chip, or LSPC. This could even be applied to the whole screen, which a number of games did to good effect to emphasize key moments, show things in more detail, or alter their perspective. Another technique that SNK utilized quite a lot was bank switching. Now, this wasn't exclusive to the Neo Geo at all, in fact it was a technique that originated on 8-bit computers, but most other consoles at the time didn't use it. What bank switching basically is, in simplest terms, is a way for developers to use more memory than a processor would normally allow. Processors can only address a certain amount of memory, so they would split the data into banks and switch what bank was currently loaded into memory as needed. What this did was allow much larger games than what would normally be possible. In the case of the Neo Geo, its initial maximum cartridge size was 330 megabits, or a little over 41 megabytes. This was already massive, as the Super Nintendo and Mega Drive capped out at 32 megabits or 4 megabytes. Games that used this original specification displayed the message Max 330 Mega Pro Gear spec on startup. And some games that exceeded 100 megabits would also display the 100 Megashock. Eventually though, thanks to bank switching, cartridge storage sizes more than doubled, pushing up to 716 megabits or almost 90 megabytes, which was significantly larger than even the biggest Nintendo 64 cartridges, which maxed out at 512 megabits or 64 megabytes. Games that utilized these larger size cartridges displayed the message Gigapower Pro Gear spec. So if you've noticed these screens on startup of Neo Geo games before and wonder what they meant, well, now you know. As a result, games got larger and more detailed with smoother animation and plenty of fancy effects, pushing the hardware to its limits in ways never thought originally possible. And even later consoles like the PS1 and Saturn struggled to keep up with it at times, at least for 2D. This was because of its unique cartridges that stored the game data on multiple fast ROM chips, which allowed it to essentially pull data directly from the ROM and display it to the screen insanely quickly. This is why the cartridges were so large physically, it was because they contained multiple ROM chips. CD-based systems, on the other hand, needed to copy data from the disc in smaller chunks to VRAM before drawing it to the screen, which was a much, much slower process, especially with the slow drive speeds at the time. Because of this setup, the Neo Geo had a surprisingly small amount of VRAM on board, only about as much as the Super Nintendo actually, because that's all it needed. It didn't need to copy graphics data to the VRAM first, it pulled it directly from the fast ROM. The VRAM was instead just used to store the tiles that made up the fixed layer and information on how to render sprites to the screen. Some of the later releases towards the end of the Neo Geo's lifespan looked amazing and every bit as good as the 2D titles available on far more powerful consoles on the market. Despite all of that power, it did come with some limitations. For example, even though it could scale the whole screen using sprite shrinking, it didn't really have anything similar to the Super Nintendo's Mode 7, so it could not do 3D style racing games particularly well, with developers instead usually opting for an overhead or isometric view. It also didn't have any of the transparency effects that the Super Nintendo had either, so it needed to fake transparency like how it was done on the Mega Drive, using techniques like dithering or flickering. Its lack of VRAM also meant that it wasn't capable of doing any 3D rendering in real time. But despite all of that, it was a 2D powerhouse, and even though its library only consisted of around 160 games, pretty much all of them are high quality and well regarded games that still look fantastic even to this day. So that's about all I wanted to cover on the Neo Geo. Hopefully you learned something and maybe appreciate it just that little bit more now. I'll finish this video off by quickly plugging my book, Secrets of Video Game Consoles. I cover facts about the Neo Geo in more detail that I only briefly touched on here, including the memory card, its game library, and the attempted 64-bit follow-up, as well as 30 other consoles over the span of about 40 years in great detail. So if you're interested in this sort of thing, check it out. I'll leave some links in the description where you can purchase it. Give me a thumbs up if you like this video, it really helps a lot. Leave a comment if you like, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.